Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the session on data-driven innovation. My name is Mukesh, and I'll go through this session today. Please keep putting your questions. Towards the end of the session, I'll take up your question and answers. Welcome. I'm Mukesh Jain, Chief Technology and Innovation Officer and Vice President for Data Technology at Capgemini, in the division of insights and data. The primary focus is how do we make data, insights, and artificial intelligence, bring it to life, help people make better decisions on those. I have about 25 years experience. Majority of my experience was building ultra large scale applications, products like Outlook, like Jio, all of them powered by AI analytics. That has been my passion and that has been my experience last 25 years. 13 years I have spent at Microsoft, and then recently at Jio 2.5 years. I also had the honor of doing the first ever AI algorithm for Microsoft in the year 1999, which I'll talk about today. I'm a regular speaker. Since 9 years back, when I came back from US, I've been teaching at IITs, IIMs, NIT. I am an adjunct faculty or advisor at a couple of places. And I publish 2 books, Delivering Successful Projects and Web Performance. And I'm writing the 3rd book on Applied AI Analytics. By the way, this is my 1,874th lecture in the last 9 years. With that, let's start. We're always busy. At least we think we are busy. You may have seen some of these pictures like this. The fact that all of you are spending 1 hour with me today means that you probably want to hear something new, something different. You want to try it out, and that's a good start. Always remember that you always need to reserve some good time for some learning something new. We never know, something may click. Now, how about another picture? I'm not a big fan of Facebook, but I had a lot of students, a lot of my professional friends who are following me on Facebook or LinkedIn. Sometimes they put some good pictures like this. I like those and I put them on my PPT just to share some thoughts process. I remember it was 1998. When I saw one of my friend's brother got a job in Intel in US. I was in Mumbai at that time, and I was fascinated by that. I said, wow, what it takes to get a job in Intel or Microsoft? There was no Google or Facebook at that time. And he said, Mukesh, forget it. You can never get a job in Microsoft. I said, why not? He said, first of all, you're not from IIT, you're not done your master's, you're not done any American university, your English is poor, you stammer, pretty much anything and everything which he couldn't think of, he told Mukesh, you can never get a job. Thinking from that angle, I could have had a mental block. I would have never tried Microsoft because my friend said so. His brother got a job in Intel, but I could have never job. But I also remembered, puchne mein kya jata hai? In English, that translates into, there is no harm in asking. And that's what I did. Sometime September 98, I applied at Microsoft. I got a job in Microsoft. A lot of time, in our career, in a lot of day-to-day activity, we try to take advice from a lot of people who may or may not be the authority, and we end up making mistakes or end up losing opportunity. Had I listened to my friend, I would have never got a job in Microsoft. Just think about it. There might be something you might be losing out. Take advice from your friend on which movie to watch, of course, after the COVID situation, or where to go for picnic and everything, but not for your career. For career, you have to go to some of the experts, some of the people, professionals who have tried and been there, done that, or some experienced people. With that, let me start. Data. We hear data a lot about nowadays. And of course, you go to the website and all, you see a lot of data science course also happening. And because of the COVID situation, a lot of people are getting there. I think it's the right thing to do. More and more data we're talking about. Let me talk about the history behind it. I'm sure a lot of you, most of you are engineers or getting to become an engineer, you would have noticed. 1750 was the start of mechanics. Mechanics have started, some of automation was happening, and it took almost 150 years to get the electric element done. 150 to get the first revolution, okay, which was electric. But after that, half of 150, approximately 70, it took almost 70 years to get electronics. 150 years, 70 years to electronics. After that, 30 plus years to get cyber system, the computers which we live in right now. It took almost that much time. And after that, tomorrow. Notice I'm saying tomorrow, I'm not saying today. AI. is a long way to go on AI, by the way. I remember in incident last year, sometime same time frame, July 2019, I was invited by NASSCOM to speak, to conduct a masterclass on AI. And I went to on the stage, about 600 CXOs were there in the audience. And I asked them, hey, have you seen AI near you? And a lot of people raised their hand. Of course, yes, we see AI near us. Be it an app, be it a software, be it something to do with AI. But when I asked them, you can lower your hand if you're just talking about chatbot or Siri or Cortana or Alexa. Most of the hands went down. Only three hands were up. Just imagine 600 CXO, only three hands up talking about something to do with AI they have seen nearby. And that is true. That is the fact of the matter. Which you call your app, try to go for Uber, and Uber is showing you like this. How much time are you going to wait for that? Few seconds? Few minutes? 7.2 seconds. 7.2 seconds is the threshold for people in India on average to wait for Uber to come in on the app, by the way. If not, what do you do? You kill the app and then go to Ola or any other app which you have in your city. That's the why? Because users have choice. Of course, when Ola says, hey, it's going to come in 20 minutes, we jump back to Uber and say, hey, let me book there. And sometimes we end up booking two so that we get the one which is faster. Users have choice is the important part we need to accept. Okay. I'm sure you all know. Okay, there was MSN Messenger. We don't even talk about it. There was Hotmail. Few people know about it. Not many people are knowing about it because when the choice was there, there was no choice. People were using Hotmail, but there were some challenges and all. When Gmail came in and all, it was very fast for India market. Most of people went there. Because when you have choice, you want to get the one which is working for you in your environment. Performance matters. Experience matters. That's what, because anytime, anywhere, on any device should be able to work. The key element over here, which I'll talk about, of course, in one session, I can only do so much. But when I'm conducting workshops and all at any colleges, any universities, I focus on this workshop on talking about how do you understand the product usage? That's what the Amazons of the world, that's what Netflix of the world, that's what Microsoft, that's what Google, that's what Facebook does every day to understand how the product has been used so that the experience can be better. I'm sure you would have seen in Office application when the box comes in which says participate in customer experience improvement program. When I came up with this idea in the year 90, and we tried, and that's what happened. Data-driven innovation. Why? Because there's a competition. People want to compete on analytics. They want to compete so that they can get value to the customer, value to the business, value to the stakeholders. That's what the current business landscape is. Okay. Decision making. This is the interesting part. As I mentioned in my session title, data-driven innovation, there's a lot of decision making happen every day. A lot of them. But who's making the decision? Yes. Once in a while, you see people which are hippo. Hippo. Highest individual paid person's opinion. Yes. Sometimes there are decisions made by hippos who are just because of the authority, just because they're highly paid, they're making decisions. Nothing wrong about that. That's how things have been done. But just imagine if you have a flavor, if you have an attitude, an element of data, you can move towards data-driven decision. Why? Because decision is everywhere. What position the ad should be there, when should I give the home loan or the credit card, what should be the next app to be shown. Imagine when you're using YouTube or Netflix, you get some recommendation. How does that really work? Do we know about it? I remember a few months back, I was just going to YouTube and I just was becoming nostalgic. I wanted to see something which was 25 year old. I was just searching. I got that song and it started playing the song. After the song was complete, I was too lazy to go and change something. And next time, strong song started from the same era. Yes, I'm not that old, by the way. So 25 years old, song started, and I kept playing all this era of the same genre, so same time, not coming back and forth. Why? Because they're trying to understand the psychology of the person who is watching. If I'm watching something out of the blue, which is of a particular era, let us show the same ones around those. Okay? So all those things trying to help get you to the best recommendation so that you feel good about it. And that's what is decision. Decision, not because I as a CXO, CTIO of the company trying to make a decision, it is because this is what the user needs. And I have to be 100% correct, by the way. And it never has to be. Even if a good percentage is good. And that's what the machine learning element comes into picture. I'm sure you would have heard these jargons, right? Data, analytics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, deep learning, all those things are jargons. They're nothing but a foundation of data, machine learning element, and so on and so forth. I'll talk about that in a few minutes. That's what I'll talk about decision. So everywhere, if we have to take decision, instead of you saying "mera wala blue" in English, my shade of blue color, or my favorite pink color, my favorite green color. Instead, if you say, no, let us look at the data and see which color is the right one for that user, which experience is the right one for the user. That's what I'm talking about, data-driven decision. Of course, color is just one of them, right? Everywhere, anything and everything, we do take a decision, a lot of them, okay? As soon as we talk about data, we have to talk about measurements. In lots of courses I teach at multiple universities and all, I always start with measurements. People say, no, Mukesh, let's start with data. No. Before data, there's one element which is measurement. How do you measure? Because if you don't know where you're going, it doesn't matter which road you take. Alice in Wonderland, I'm sure you know about that. Data. Data is a qualitative and or qualitative measurement. Quantitative, qualitative. Quantitative, qualitative. Quantitative, numbers, numeric. Think about it. As soon as I use the word data, what came to your mind? Just think about it. Maybe an Excel sheet with lots of columns, some data. That's what our belief is on the data. Data, quantitative, numeric. That's only 3.9% of the world's data. Yes. Surprised? Yes. 3.9% of the data is numeric in format, in tabular, structured. Very, what is the other data? Your text, your images, your videos are data, because every activity or inactivity generates data. Most of the books and reaction material will refer to this as if every activity generates data. I don't believe that. I think even inactivity generates data. So every activity and inactivity generates data, because I'm sure all of you, since 6 p.m. today, you're not checked. That's your inactivity generating data. I used to wear an IoT watch, a Fitbit, which captures my activity and inactivity. And something tells me, this was the time I was sleeping. Fitbit doesn't know what that is. They say, oh, yes, this is what Mukesh's signals are when he's active, and of course, when he's inactive. All of those things, when we talk about structure and structured data, all of those things coming together. Think about it. You have Flipkart order delivered to you. You get a quantitative. That's a quantitative. So the text, the package was good, but this was bad, something like that. That's a qualitative part. Unstructured, equally valuable. So a combination of this becomes your data. But the underlying element is the measurement. However, the measurement element part of it, okay? Data tells a lot of a summary. I'm going to ask you a question, quick question. 2020, what does 2020 come to you? 2020? 2020 is cricket, of course, right? Yes, India, what else came in 2020? But you also know 2020 is a Parley biscuit. 2020 is a book by Abdul Kalam. 2020 is a weight loss program in US. And of course, 2020 vision, 2020 year, lots of meaning of 2020. How do you know when you search for 2020? Hello? Yeah? Hello? Okay. Is it okay now? Yeah. Is it? Yeah? Yeah. Okay, let me move it. One second. Okay. Is it better now?
Okay, I started present my screen now. Okay, continue present. I was talking about intent. Intent. When 2020 has so much meaning, how do you determine what is the intent of the user? Imagine if an American comes to India and searching for 2020 and we tell them eat Parle biscuit or a class program or a talk show, right? So that's why it's important to understand the intent of what person is doing. This is from the search perspective, from a browse perspective, it could be anything. There is thing from the persona perspective, you can think about a more broader perspective also. All of those things, activity I'm talking about, all of them are useless if you don't put a rupee or a dollar symbol near that. That is what in element of analytics. I'm sure a lot of you have heard about this word analytics a lot. Even though the activity has started several decades back, but the enabler in nowadays. Analytics. What is analytics? It's a scientific process of deriving insights. The important part is down to a rupee symbol or a dollar symbol. The reason for that is because everything what we do, if it drives business value, of course, if it's the government, it to drive the value of the term. Okay. Now if you look at the pyramid of those, you start with the measurement, which is a foundation, which generates data. And this data, when you look at it, you get information out of the data. This particular store did a sale of, let's say, 10 lakh rupees yesterday. That's your measurement. The data is 10 lakh rupees sale which has happened. Now, your information would be normally why, what, how. That's your insight. Then you take a decision. Okay, let's stop this. Let's start doing this. Decision. And then you convert into action. So, strike on the time you do it from the measurement, physics measurement, what is the foundation I need to build it, what BI dashboard I'm going to use, I'm going to use Tableau or Power BI, how do I get information so that I can just start doing analytics and forecasting, which model goes, action is it is taken. If it is taken, drives to business results. Okay. Together, if I have to put all of them together, you start with the data. It could be big data, it could be regular data, it doesn't matter. That's the core part of it. On analytics, you do start doing machine learning. So if you look at the sphere of influence, things are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. At the heart, at the core, is still your data. And on top comes artificial intelligence. So if you ever talk about virtual reality, augmented reality, which is there, What does it mean? It's artificial intelligence and machine learning in action. Or it could be talking about robotics. If you're talking about digital transformation, it's talking about data and analytics helping you take decision, digital decision. Or it could be IoT, your industry 4.0, which includes additions are there. These are, of course, the top technologies. Which is how it integrates together. So that is what I'm trying to highlight here. Let's talk about some examples. So I'm sure, so that you can relate to this, that this was done on data. The main element I want you to take away is how it was done on data. Let's start with this. User behavior. Remember in the beginning I talked about how this would be. In the beginning, a dialogue box which comes to you, your customer experience improvement program, that is what it is. So I built this system at Microsoft 99-2000 time frame, and the purpose was to see what activity person does so that we can understand the behavior. No PR people are doing, so I can identify top 25 tasks. Top 25 tasks, so that I would know that what people are really doing, and accordingly see what how can be optimized. And that's what the output was in Office Design. Just to give you a flavor, you notice this. Let me just give you this element. Just 1 second. Yeah, just 1 second. Now, if you notice, you would have seen this menu item was history. Lot of this was done in this way. Most of the applications. But now, when you see the applications, look at these menu items. Lot more rich menu. Much richer menu item. The purpose was, can I help people do it in one click or two click? User experience. Data-driven innovation. User experience was done using data right now. Or it could be color of search results. Notice why the color of the search is blue always? Why not light blue? Why not green? Why not purple? Right? Again, a lot of research was there. And one of the different shades of blue for our users, and see which shade of blue gives us better see-through. Why not? Right? Because instead of me saying mera wala blue, or in English, my shade of
algorithm at best to be able to understand what's happening and how it can improve us. Okay. E-commerce. Think about e-commerce, right? Amazon, Flipkart of the world. How does recommendation engine work? Okay. You'll be surprised to know. Last time I checked, Amazon US, 65% of the sale happening on Amazon was because of recommendation engine. It's a pretty high number. Just imagine you're going there to buy one product, one book. You can, for let's say, take an example of my book, Delivering Successful Projects. You're going there to buy one book and you end up buying three books. Two out of three, 66%. That's what the numbers are. 65% of the books sold by Amazon at that time was based on recommendation engine. Of course, I'm not talking about the same thing for mobile phone. You go to buy one phone, you don't buy three phones. I'm not talking about that. But the places that recommendation engine works, it works. Right? So thinking about how those complex algorithm works so that people can be enticed to buy more items. And there's a psychology behind that. The reason we are talking more about data, how do you get into the psychology piece? As soon as you think about buying a book, I'm just focusing on a book right now. As soon as you think about buying a book, I want to buy this particular book. The sale has already happened in your mind. You're going to the site just to make the transaction. But while doing that, if there are two more books come to me, oh, this looks good, and you want to buy those also, that is what the real additional sale the book Amazon is having. Otherwise, the first book you would have already purchased, right? All those things plus which targeting should be done, how do you get email, what time of the day you should get email, when do you click, and all those parts, all done using data. Okay, I'm sure some of you are thinking about joining e-commerce company, or some of you are already there and all, and you will be able to see how robust the recommendation engine are to make it work, and all centered about a human psychology, human persona. Okay, or it could be something when you're working on an app and it crashes. I'm sure you have seen this button, by the way. Send error report. 1999, when I came up with this idea, hey, how about this? If it crashes, let's collect the data. Not many people were excited. They said, no, okay, it will not work, question mark, blah, blah, blah. But when I started doing this, I was capturing the information to see why it crashed. Was it the code problem? Was it the scenario? Or was it something to do with the user data? Wrong data was coming, or machine configuration, or network. Have you noticed? Sometimes when you have very slow network on your mobile phone, your application crashes, doesn't work. All those ideas in 1999, 21 years back, when we're thinking about it, let me capture that information and find out. The more and more people clicked on standard report, the better the product becomes. Nowadays, you don't see this button, right? You can thank me for that, because the product has improved drastically. And my favorite, junk filter. I'm sure you all get junk email. When you get junk email, 10, 20, 30, you would be very, very much upset about that, right? Why are you getting so much junk email? If I ask you this question, what is this junk email for you? Some of you might think about advertisement, some of you might think about something else, and you are just thinking, oh, this is junk, that is junk. Imagine Bill Gates getting junk email, 15,000 a day. Yes, you heard it right. 15,000 junk email per day, that is what he was getting. And when we were discussed, I was very new to Microsoft, 4 years experience or so, and people thinking about how can be done. And I raised my hand. Of course, I was not selected to work on this project, but I thought something can be done. And I'll tell you what the algorithm was. A simple algorithm. Simple algorithm to solve junk problem. A lot of time we think about data. And I kept saying data. But we have to also see what data, how data. Instead of focusing on the email type, I focus on the behavior of the user. Behavior. Think about it. If you get a junk email, are you going to read the junk email for more than 5 seconds? Think about it. Are you going to delete an important email in less than 3 seconds? Think about it. If the answer is no for both of them, that's your junk filter. That's the algorithm I wrote. 221 lines of code in C language. Yes, there was no Python, no R, no machine learning. I had no machine learning classes and all. The only part I was thinking about, can I have a behavioral element of it? And using artificial intelligence concepts. See, artificial intelligence, people think is a technology. It's not a technology, it's a concept. The more you think about it, when I teach AI at IIT Mumbai and some of the other places, my focus is to help people understand the concept part of it. I'm an advisor to a couple of universities where I change or overhaul the whole syllabus of AI to focusing more on the concept, the thought process. How do you come up with that algorithm so the machine can be intelligent? And that's what they require. Artificial intelligence. The intelligent word is there. Okay. So that's what I did. I started collecting this data and slowly the machine started learning about me. Yes, machine learning. So it started learning, hey, Mukesh doesn't like email from this particular time. Hey, Mukesh like this email from these people. Let me see what the email is and then come up with those model. And then that's what deep learning happens and see, hey, you know what? When the email has these filters, 94% chance that Mukesh will not like it. If email has that thing, 65% chance that Mukesh will like it. All those together, the probability, the statistics all coming together and giving you a score. The score, which is it junk or not? Based on that, you make a decision and the email is flagged. I could be wrong. Perfectly fine. That's why the whole learning happens. Nobody expects it to be perfect in the first day. It was not perfect in the first day, by the way. I started with 72% accuracy, went up to 84%, closer to 90%. That's when it was implemented on Bill Gates' mailbox. Over a period of 1 week, it became 94%. And that's where I said, I think this is good enough. 15,000 junk email, 94% accuracy. I think people will take it. I give you some examples. I give you the journey from data to some of these elements, some elements of those. Of course, in 1 hour, how much you can do, you can understand this part. Let me quickly touch on the careers. Careers, in my 25 years, I've done pretty much a lot of this element. And I mentioned, right, a lot of those underlying, which was career of AI and all. But some people think, oh, you have to do data science from the beginning. You have to do data science. You have to reset your career or only for students. It is not. No, it is there for everybody. Everybody, including people at 25, 30 years experience level, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, everybody, something is there for them. Because the more, just remember the example I mentioned in the beginning? If 600 CXOs don't know what the AI is, and this is what the example is for them. Yes, people need to talk about data every day. The decision making has to change. Career. Harvard Business Review talked about this about 8 years back. The success job of 21st century. Yes, 8 years back. And now we see the reality. Bloomberg recently published a report about six months back, $500 billion, $500 trillion and market for this. Okay, more and more demand is coming, by the way, on this data. Happy to be part of the team who does this every day. What are the industry expectation? Industry expectation is not for somebody to come with a certificate or degree and say, hey, I know data. Yes, it's a good starting point. But more about how are you able to leverage data for getting some business value. The business value, the dollar and rupees, remember I talked about? People who can understand data, who can understand analytics modeling, all of those things coming together and focusing on how things work. If I ask you this question, how Google Map works, some of you may think about it. Yes, it works this way. Good start. But you have to also remember, it does a lot of AI, a lot of machine learning, a lot of data, a lot of analytics has been used there. Similarly for other products. So if you start thinking about some of the best successful products of the world, look at this, how they use data and all. I'm sure you might be thinking about WhatsApp also, right? It does not use as much of data, but yes, there are a lot of other places where recommendation comes in, where some kind of intelligent behavior comes in. That's what the data is being used. Ability for somebody to come up with the idea. One of the beliefs I have is a person with a new idea is a crank until the idea succeeds. Somebody who can come up with an idea, who is finding out opportunity with data, is what is required here. Okay, somebody who is able to solve a particular problem using data. That's what the industry expectation is. People who are continuously upskilling themselves. And my mantra in my life is jack of all trade, master of some, not none, some. Jack of all trade, master of none is the old thing. Jack of trade, all trade, master of some is, I think, more and more demand in the industry is right now. Okay, there are some skills required. Of course, we all know you cannot just do without the skills. Data skills are required, and I see a lot of universities where I'm at least where I'm advisor, some of the places I've seen, they're taking a leap, a big leap of moving into more and more data. At least in this year, I would say four different universities have launched a degree program in data science, right? Wow. End-to-end data science as a degree program in BE. A lot of things are moving in that direction. I hope a lot of other universities also accept this, but this is the future. A computer science with data science, or even if you're doing mechanical or electronics, a flavor of data science, some of the electives of data science is a good start for you to get that. And by the way, just to remind you all, data science is not just for computer science students or IT students. It is for every engineering part, because in fact, there are more opportunities for manufacturing electronics than in computer science and all. Of course, we need computers, we need systems to use data science, but yes, the industry could be any of them. Okay. So first thing, let me talk about is curiosity. In Hindi, jigyasa, something to learn more, curious mindset. Just think about a child and in your house. Okay. 1 year, 1.5 years, how curious that person is, the child is. That is what the curiosity is. Unfortunately, for various things happening nearby, we probably kill our curiosity because somebody said, hey, I said so. Don't do this. Teacher, parents, it could be anything. You try to fix your creativity because of the fear of failure. Fear of failure because, oh, what if somebody laughs at me? Albert Einstein once said, I'm never clever, neither clever or especially gifted. I'm only very, very curious. Curiosity. Okay. And Mark Twain is, ain't what you don't know gets into trouble. It's what you know for sure, but that's not true. That's what the challenge is. More and more people are now talking about curiosity because if you're more curious at every age, that's what we learn. By the way, I just did my M.Tech sometime last year from BITS Pilani. Why? I'm curious to learn new things. Now I'm going for PhD. I'll finalize my institution in a couple of months and then decide where I want to do my PhD. Curious, continuous attitude towards learning. When you're talking about data and all, it needs a more of an aptitude as well. How do you understand data, the different models, how do you understand the business domain where you need to be applied, and some technical knowledge. A combination of those. Understanding of the data. If I give you a set of data, can you sniff the data and then find out a pattern? Which analytics model to be used when? People are going to ask you, hey, please do analytics model, this analytics model for me. No, nobody does that. People say, hey, this is my business domain. Please come and solve the problem, or please find an opportunity to solve. That's what happened. Nobody told me to write junk filter. Nobody told me to do analytics on the crash. But you find out the domain, you think about it, come up with some model, come up with some understanding, and then do it. And that's where the business value are. That's your aptitude around those. And most important, attitude. One of the things which I learned in my life, and I taught my kids as well, the attitude was, for any question asked by anybody or any opportunity, just raise your hand. If you know the answer, definitely raise your hand. You might laugh at this, by the way. It all boils down to puchne mein kya jata hai, or there is no harm in asking. The reason I'm emphasizing on this point is because a lot of times the fear of failure of what will do, what will happen if somebody laughs at me and all. I told you in the beginning, I used to stammer, right? People used to laugh at it, which is okay. But if you don't have that attitude, if you start thinking about, no, I don't know what will happen and all, you get into a shell and then your creativity is lost. You become just an order taker. Somebody tells you what to do and then you do it. For a successful data science person or somebody who's successful in their career, are the people who have the right attitude to challenge status quo, to do more than what is asked for. And that's where raising hand for any opportunity is what the expectation is. Curiosity, learning new things, how things work, I've already talked about. And analytics in anything and everything. This is what I've seen, one of my probably attitude of let me try analytics doing here and all. And of course, getting an ownership mindset helps you always. Okay. So this is what I wanted to talk about, a little bit of our journey, a little bit of some of the example, a little bit about how do you do some practical element of it. I hope it was useful. Quickly concluding this, and then I'll open up for question. I'm sure you would have put your question already. I'll take some of those questions towards the end. Two more slides and we'll be done. The top 20 technologies, if you look at it, the most important one or the most talked about is artificial intelligence. Have you done something about it? Not much. Are people teaching about it? Yes, of course. One of the university I was talking to, I will not name the university. I was looking at the syllabus and I see the book they are referring to, 13 years old book. I said, I don't even have to look at the title and all. Just change it. Just get a new one. This is changing, ever-changing world. One of the university advisors, yes, Mukesh, we change syllabus every 4 years. I said, no, every year. Again, it's easier said than done, of course. I know that. But again, there are people in the industry, people like me, people, a lot of other people who are practitioner. Every day I practice at Capgemini, I practice with my client, I talk about future of artificial intelligence and all. If you search for it, you'll see a lot of my articles online. But that's when we should be ahead, getting the industry connected and then helping them of what the IoT can be done, how are you going to for mobile part, the blockchain piece, the big data part, all of those things, what is happening in the industry, bringing it to academia and then helping it get there. So this is in closure, my personal learnings have been. The first and foremost, I've talked about it a couple of times today. Puchne mein kya jata hai? In English translates into try. Because a person with a new idea is a crank until the idea succeeds. Even if you don't try, how will you get a new idea? Results without actions, so action without results are noise. We have to go for the results. Okay, the gone are the time that you say, hey, I tried. People don't want that. People want results ultimately. If someone else can find a mistake, why can't you yourself find it? I taught it to my kids when they were in the early childhood, and I could see that, you know, my daughter came first in mathematics, her name comes in Times of India, my son cleared SAT 100% marks, all because you can have that attitude that yes, if somebody else can find a mistake, why can't you yourself find it? Focus on knowledge, success will follow. That's what I learned from Three Idiots. Your Subchintak. The word Subchintak in English translates into well-wisher. I think Subchintak have better meaning. The Subchintak will give you candid feedback. Sometimes people say, oh no, he's against me, he's giving me all the negative points. No, you want candid feedback, get it from your Subchintak or your well-wisher. Plan, estimate, track. If you want to get into data, more and more and more data about it, you need to do data every day. Every day data, plan, estimate, track, improve, all of those parts. There's learning in everything. Everything you do, there's learning, right? Again, learn from it, collect data and learn it. Do what you enjoy. And that's what my experience has been. Last 25 years, I would say maybe there were 6 months in all, total, give or take, where I probably did not enjoy what I was doing. I'm enjoying every day. Every day what I do, I enjoy. And that's what I'm having fun. And by the way, I'm getting paid for that. Give back time to community. This is my way of giving back time to community, back to all of you. With that, I will pause here. I'm sure you know this. I'll pause here and then go back to your questions. You can ask me anything. I've given my credentials here, Facebook or LinkedIn. I'll prefer Facebook because LinkedIn, I'm already maxed out. So you can ask me anything. I'm going to stop sharing my screen now and see, take you are giving me. Okay, I'll stop my screen now. To the screen where I can see all your questions. I see a lot of you have given questions. I'm going to take some of you, your question, and I'm going to wear my glasses to have better reading thing for me. Okay, I see some question already. One second. Question. Yeah, here it is. Okay, Siti, mention your question. Okay, data structure part is there. It's a third year. Okay. Okay, I'm my third year bachelor's degree. I want to know field of data science, where to start, and what do I learn to become data scientist? Shubham, good question. See, data science can start anytime, as I mentioned, right? It could start at people with 25 years experience. It could start when you're in first
engineering, or even before that. That's where my son started learning data science long time back. So for you, I would suggest start reading some of the material. There are lots of courses available online. Some of them are free, some of them are paid. Go through those and start getting that attitude toward data science. Take a lot of data. Lots of data available on Kaggle, which you can try out. And then try and use those for your day-to-day activity. Very useful explanation. Okay, fine. Thank you for that, Bhumika.
Next question is, what is your future data science
consulting firm?
Good question, SK.
SK from Delhi is asking, giving the point. So the data science that we talk about, right? Of course, there are a lot of consulting firms who are doing, there are a lot of companies, including my company, who is into data science as well. I would say the future of this data science is threefold. Threefold when I talk about, first and foremost is for people to collect data,
a lot of them. Second, opportunities. Coming up with opportunities. That's why consulting company come into picture. Then who can guide, who can tell people how data can be used. That's the second part of it. And third part, needless to say, getting the results. So if you have the good set of data, if you have that mindset, you will get the results. So these three becomes more important. And data consultancy firm is in the big demand right now because of that.
Okay. Now I'm looking at the next question.
Sir, how can you utilize data for rural healthcare? Very good question, Nadim from Delhi. If you look at it, AI for Good was an initiative launched by our government a few years back.
Yeah, artificial intelligence for good. For good, it includes healthcare, education, and agriculture. Healthcare, education, these are three major ones. So if I look at it, healthcare, right? So we have to come up with more and more easy to implement elements. Yes, some of the best one is telemedics, right? On the phone, you are doing it. With COVID, this became a lot more popular. But as we go forward, how can we use artificial intelligence to prevent some of these things like COVID situation and there? A lot more research to be done in this area. I think I would suggest people who are in healthcare, people who are trying to get there or associated with healthcare, a good portion of this can be done. I am mentoring one person, a PhD student, I'm mentoring last couple of months, who is into healthcare. And the purpose there is to see how AI can be used, not just to collect data and do something good, but also using some of the AI concept to be able to get better and better in healthcare, focus on rural healthcare. So there are a lot of opportunities, Nadim, can be done in this area. Good area for focus. Topic is very interesting, useful.
Thank you. Thank you for that, Apurva. Thank you. And can a student, next question is from Manju. Manju from UAE. Manju, your question is, can a student pursue a degree in data science if he's studying commerce till 12? Manju, very good question. In fact, some of the people I'm talking to and mentoring, I have seen
a big number of people from BCom, BSc, and even some of them BA background. It is not related to the degree you take, right? It could be engineering, it could be non-engineering, it doesn't matter. As long as your attitude towards mathematics, attitude towards data is good. Just to test out, just see how good are you in stats, how good are you in probability. If you're good there, anybody can do it. There are two languages primarily used in data science. Until 2 years back, it was R. Now Python is getting more and more popular. Python have overtaken R last 2 years. Having said that, if people come from engineering background, they would prefer Python. Python have about 4,000 libraries. But people from non-engineering background, statistician, BSc, BCom people, they would typically prefer R. And R have 10,000 data packages or packages, you can call it, for analytics and AI, which means that a lot of research is already done in R. R is good for non-engineering one because the way you program is very, 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 very simple. Yes, you have to do some programming, but you don't have to be engineer. So BCom also can be done. And I've done a lot of people who have seen it. Some mathematics is required. If you're not done mathematics at all in your career, just try it out and see if you can still do it. If not, then probably data science is not for you. Next question
from Kerala. Fatima, is there any meeting link for this? Okay, on meeting link. What real life example data innovation? So I've talked about this already. Zenith, I already talked about it in my session. I see some example, there is a policy, okay. Can you tell public policy consideration for data innovation? Somaya from Warangal. So this part, public policy. I was involved in the early days
of a Niti Aayog discussion on data policy, which was around how we can have data protection, how we can have the right policy in using data. There was a contribution there. Indian government is very, very focused on this, and I have done my contribution as well. You would see a draft policy is already published by Justice Sri Krishna that covers some of the element, and I have contributed there as well. Lot more is coming soon. Will be there a lot of policy around this.
I can't have policy around innovation. Those will be more on the corporate side. But yes, how you can use data, how you can have ethics in data is part of the policy, by the way. Next question I'm taking now is from Anusha from Raichur. One second. It was voice not clear. Okay, Anusha. I see some other question. Why your voice sounds like robotic? I don't know, Pritham. Maybe some technical glitch there. Okay. I think the number of people who attended was high. Maybe some issue on the volume side. Let me talk about some other questions. Okay. Now the next question is from Nihal. Nihal from UAE. Nihal, your question is, I have interest in AI, but I'm not sure what to take
because 12th was without maths. Nihal, if you're interested in AI and if you're not done mathematics, that's okay. Just go to some of the courses on internet. It could be from Coursera, it could be from Khan Academy, it could be from Udemy. Try it out for a few days. If that excites you, make sure the commitment of money is not very high. If that excites you, you can be doing this. As I mentioned, people need to be passionate about mathematics. Even if you have not done it, as long as you're passionate, you should be fine.
Interesting sessions from you, Adesha. Thank you from Bhubaneswar. Next question is from Dr. Shrikant Upadhyay from Rashi. How AI will come to ground or in real picture for rural and urban people? So Dr. Shrikant, so people like you and me, as and when we use more and more AI and bring those applications, bring those startups who can do service for them, will be useful. I'm sure some of you would have read about it, Swachh Bharat Abhiyan and Shauchalayas across India. A lot of AI was used in that area to make sure
it's something has been built and taking pictures regularly and using AI. It was confirmed that yes, the thing was well spent, the money was well spent, and the Shauchalaya was actually built. A lot of AI was used. Some of us can do this.
Next question is from Argadeep from Howrah, from West Bengal. How the data innovation can utilize the sales cycle of sales funnel? Argadeep, sales is used AI a lot. I just implemented some of the sales related AI for one of our clients in UK.
What it does is it looks at the pattern. It looks at the pattern of people purchase a pattern and correlate with the dollar price, correlate with the fuel price, correlate with the oil price, all of those together, and gives you elements about, yes, these are the four type of clients who will be more interested in sales next coming weeks, or these are the clients who will have more impact because of COVID. This is the demand which is happening. These are the third external variables which are going to impact your sales. All of those things come into picture here, and that drives the data. This machine learning element, if you are able to capture those elements, become much easier. That's why you can do prediction. Imagine if you are able to predict that these are the four customers who's going to buy and not this 10. And if you focus your campaign only to these four, your chances of them conversion becoming much, much higher rather than sending a blanket SMS to thousands and thousands of people saying that, hey, please do the loan and all. That doesn't work, right? When you're getting those bombarded with the junk SMS and all.
Reshma, good. Thank you. Thank you for the feedback. Neatly explained. Thank you, Nagalakshmi, for your feedback. How do you improve knowledge of cloud computing? Vinushri from Coimbatore, how do you improve your knowledge of cloud computing? So, Vinushri, I think the element here is what element of cloud? Cloud, when you talk about, we talk about five different elements. Cloud as a storage, cloud as anywhere
part of it, demand, on-demand compute, cloud as an analytics portion, cloud as a data side of it, or cloud as an AI side of it. You have to focus on those elements. I would suggest more and more cloud. It could be Google Cloud, it could be Microsoft Azure, or it could be Amazon AWS. Any of the cloud is good, and the more we use it is better. Don't use cloud only for the storage or only for the IaaS, infrastructure as a service. The more you use for AI analytics and all, it better, because even now, recently, I've seen Google have launched Google Colab. It gives you good analytics workbench to be able to try new things. And that's where people can start. That's where you can learn more. All of them are free. I think the website is colab.google.com, something like that. We should be able to try it out. This is good, by the way.
The question from Yogesh is from Pune, Yogesh. Question is, hi, Mukesh sir, is business intelligence ETL dead now?
Yogesh, I would say no. Business intelligence has evolved. ETL is still required. ETL stands for extract, transform, and load. Business intelligence is still required, but then the expectation has evolved. Expectation has evolved and is no longer a BI slicing and dicing data, but now it's more about
how I can do forecasting model, how we can integrate in my day-to-day element of decision making. Business intelligence. Intelligence was what happened, how it happened. Now we're taking it to the forecasting element, what you can do to improvise, what you can do to make it better. That is what is happening now, and that's what your business intelligence is now, forecasting model and all. So that is what I would suggest to think about. Next element.
Great, thank you. Good lecture. Thank you for that feedback.
Next one, Vivekanand. Vivekanand from Bengaluru. Question is, how relevant is data science for aerospace profession?
Vivekanand, I would say if there were two industry who used data science early was aerospace and clinical trials in the pharmacy. These are the two one who have been using this for, I would say, more than 50 years. Autopilot has been around for a long time. Autopilot, a mechanical use of data science, continuously looking at it. There was not as much machine learning, but AI was there. But machine learning nowadays, more and more can be done on aerospace to be able to reduce the fatalities which is happening in the aerospace. It could be 5 fatalities in a year, 2 fatalities in the year can be further reduced. A lot more opportunity in this area. Again, machine learning comes handy over here. Next question is from Babakar from Surikunda, Gambia.
What is the importance of data-driven innovation? Okay, so my answer to that is, I covered briefly in my session. Answer to that is more and more competition. When more and more competition is there happening, you need to understand how people are going to use it. And that's what you need to become more toward data-driven innovation. The examples I gave about Uber and Ola. Imagine if Uber doesn't know why users are going away from them. Imagine if Ola doesn't know what the user really wants. They cannot do anything here. And that's what is important here. Next question is from Dhruvi. If I want to start production of fungi, can I remove pollution from environment? I'm sorry, I won't be able to answer that, Dhruvi, that question. Let me take the next question from Rahul. Rahul from Kollam. How integrating data from innovation help among engineering students? Rahul, this is very important. If you look at it in your curriculum, if you are doing something
to do with computer science or IT, you probably have 1 or 2 subjects already. But when I talk about data science, if your subject increases to about 4 or 5, the different models, how to use Python for those, how to use data management systems, how to use distributed data computing, all of those things come handy to make you more prepared for data science. Imagine if you're going through a course, a 6-month course or a year course, part-time, 2 or 3 hours, how much you can learn compared to a workshop or a subject by itself, which helps you teach a lot more when you're doing it through engineering in practical. And some of the, not one subject, multiple subject, that's where you get that. But having said that, I also tried doing workshops, a proper subjects or elective for some of the universities, and that have helped as well. So it's a combination of that. You'll have to really talk to your faculty and see what can be done. But especially for third year students, a lot of opportunities that can be done. I see another question. I'll take 2 more questions and I'll finish it.
On time at 7. Let me see what other questions are there. Aditi saying knowledgeable. Thank you, Aditi. Okay, next question is on Ganga. Ganga, question is it possible to work in the domain under professors from top university? Ganga, I'm sure it's possible to do that. What I've seen, a lot of these projects are published by the universities on the research side of it.
Either a PhD or even when you're doing master thesis and all, you can probably work with them. That's how I have learned a lot of those elements from working closely with some of the university professors. And by the way, other way around is also true. I've given internship to several of the professors of top universities. In my company, it could be tier 2, tier 3 universities as well. The willingness, the attitude for coming and becoming intern at a corporate if with 15 years, 20 years experience also is fine. Or it could be a course doing faculty development workshop, which I've done for BITS Pilani, which I've done for several top universities. It could be that. It need to be a combination. It need to be a combination of the learning because there are a lot of things you can learn from academia, which I always cherish. And I'm talking to faculty, some of the research and all. At the same time, a lot of things can be learned from the industry, what's happening in the industry as well. Next question
is from, very informative, thank you. Next question is from Akash from Kolkata. What should be the next step in machine learning for someone who knows Python and few of his
library? So Akash, libraries are good, but that's not everything. So Akash, the more and more you look at data, the more you are open for looking at Kaggle, some of the thing you want to try out. That's where it will get it. So for you, Akash, the next step is pick a domain, pick something and see how I can use machine learning. Lots of data are available. You can try it out. You can pick insurance. You can pick banking. You can pick manufacturing. You can pick COVID. You can pick any of those. I see a lot of questions on there.
But unfortunately, I'm out of time. Let me take one last question and I'll be done. Next question is from Pradeep. Python is necessary to learn AI. How much of data analytics side? Pradeep, no, it is not required or mandatory to do Python. It's not required to do R. It can be some other language also. But yes, when you're looking at the data, when you're automating it, when you're writing some code, you will need something to work on. Either it could be Python or R. If you're hesitant in programming, if you're not done any programming,
I would suggest go with R. R is the best way to go forward. Okay. And that's about it.
That's all the question I'm able to cover today in the time I had. Thank you very much for your time.
Looking at the feedback and all, I see you are saying people language, the lecture was helpful. Thank you. Please stay in touch. Happy to get connected further and see if I can further contribute to you or your college or your university. Thank you. Thank you all. Bye. Have a good evening.